Hi everyone, I'm Angela and welcome to my channel. Today I'll be going through 10 tips to get a 7 on your IB Mathematics AAHL exam. These are tips that I've learned from my experience doing IB Mathematics AAHL and hope they help you to get a 7 on your final mathematics exam. So don't be afraid to choose AAHL as it is not as difficult as you've imagined, and this course is definitely beneficial for students who want to study mathematics related courses or econ, engineering, etc. in college. So let's get started. Tip number one, make sure you have solid knowledge of all of the math content. Even though by purely grasping all the content will not secure you a 7, but it sets up a good foundation. Most of the content taught in class is quite straightforward and direct, but IB questions are more complicated and often link various concepts together. So you'll need to have a very good knowledge of the concepts and the definitions to begin with in order to find links and solve harder questions. For example, lots of IB function questions can easily connect with trigonometry. Don't ignore the basics, as you'll find the harder IB questions that you initially can't do are mostly related to the definitions that you're not familiar with. Tip number two, start doing IB styled questions early. Even if you understand all of the concepts in class, you really need a lot of practice to be able to apply these concepts. Some IB questions are quite direct, where you can directly apply these concepts, but with medium to harder questions, like questions with more than 7 marks, it is very likely that you'll need to apply two concepts from different areas and try to find a link between them. This is the part where a lot of people can't actually recognize the concepts being tested and don't know where to start. This comes with practice, but also solid knowledge of the concepts. Tip number three, how to attempt a question that you don't really know how to do. When encountering questions you don't really know how to solve, try to identify the topic area first, and then write out all the information in the question and also the unknown. Then you should try to find links between the information given and your unknown. When doing practice questions, don't spend more than 10 minutes on a question. If you can't figure it out, look at the answer and then try to understand the reason and the hints behind each step. Don't just leave it and never come back to it, as next time you still won't be able to solve similar styled questions, and in some cases, IB questions are a little bit repetitive. In the real exam, if you don't really know how to solve the question and has already spent 2 to 3 minutes on it, skip it and then come back to it when you finish all the other questions. That way you'll be more relaxed and you'll find the hints that you've missed previously. Even if you still can't do it, IB Maths Paper 1 and Paper 2 each has 110 marks. Even if you lose 22 marks, that's still 80%, and in most cases, that's a mid to high 7. Well, that also depends on the cutoff percentage each year. Tip number 4, have a mistakes book and start this early. Each time you've did a question wrong, after looking at the answer and knowing how to do it, keep a record of it, either on an Excel spreadsheet or an exercise book. I used an exercise book because it takes time to type math symbols in an Excel document, but Excel is good because you can organize the questions into topic areas and calculate the number of wrong questions in each area to find your weakest topic and then focus on doing questions on that topic. I recommend writing out the entire question and then redo it in this book or Excel document. The most important part is that after doing the question again, you should write down why you initially got it wrong in a red pen and what you need to do to no longer make the same mistake. So this leads me into my tip number 5. Tip number 5, don't write careless as a reason of making a mistake or calculating a wrong answer. Trust me, other than writing 33 as 44 or copying down the wrong information from the question should be regarded as careless mistakes, everything else has a fundamental reason that is just not careless. If you've always made calculation errors, well, that might be because you're rushed. This means you either have issues with your time management or you're doing questions too slowly in general. And what's the cause of that? You're either not familiar enough with the concepts or need to learn how much time to devote to each question. It might also be that you calculate too slowly. Well, then you just need to practice with your calculations, and that has nothing to do with the concepts. So these are all fundamental reasons that you'll need to dig and find rather than labeling your mistake as careless and then ignore it or leave it. Everyone has careless mistakes, but it should never take you down a grade boundary. Instead, it will only make you fluctuate within the grade boundary. So if that happens, make sure you find out the fundamental reasons behind your mistakes. Tip number 6, time management. Time management is essential for all 3 papers. Generally speaking, you should spend as much time as the marks available to each question. For instance, you should spend around 3 minutes for a 3-mark question. A general guideline that I use when doing paper 1s is that you should spend 1 hour for section A, which includes 9 questions, and the remaining hour for section B, which is the extended response. Keep in mind that you should aim to finish section A as quickly as possible, as the exam is typically structured from easy problems to harder problems, and section B also has more marks. If you know you have time management issues, you can always try to do section B first, as it is worth more marks. But generally, start with section A, because normally the first 2 to 3 questions are quite easy, and it will place you in a nice mood for harder questions. Tip number 7. Questions are generally linked in section B and paper 3. I'm surprised by how many students not knowing this. Most IB questions are nice because they link together. For instance, part A might be a show that question. And even if you don't know how to do part A, you can still use the result from the show that question to do part B, and just don't give up. And if there is a show that question, you also need to expect that the result is being used in the following parts. So try to find hints from the previous parts to be able to solve the following parts. Especially when you encounter words like hence. Hence basically means that you need to use the previous result. This is also very important in paper 3 because paper 3 consists of 2 extended response questions. So the parts are generally all linked together. So paper 3 generally will have a few show that questions or proof questions. You should always use these results in paper 3. Otherwise, you'll find it very difficult to do paper 3. Tip number 8, use your formula booklet and your calculator. I'm surprised by how many people who don't actually know how to properly use their calculator or struggles to find a formula. Firstly, the formula booklet basically has all the formula needed for the course, so make sure you're really familiar with them. Try to memorize the formula when doing practice questions, as in this way you'll be very familiar with them and where they are and why they're used. But in the real exam, definitely use the formula booklet, as you don't want to lose marks on questions you know how to do but memorize the formula incorrectly. Now, calculator for paper 2. Use a calculator whenever you can. This way you'll be able to solve questions quicker and with greater accuracy. Remember, graph screen is always your friend. Finding maximum, minimum, derivatives, etc. can be simply done on the graph screen, so it is very useful. Also, keep in mind that there are a few concepts that require the calculator, and it is generally quite difficult and hard to remember. So remember to revise them before your calculator part exam. This includes the Euler's method calculations, regression lines, and in general, the use of spreadsheets. Tip number 9, summary notes are not as useful as you think. Don't spend a lot of time writing summary notes for maths because there are literally no questions asking you to recall a definition of a concept. So if you really like summary notes, you can find summary notes online and not make them yourself. Remember, doing practice questions are much more useful than making notes in maths. But you need to be aware of the order of doing things and revising. Definitely start with grasping and understanding all of the concepts and definitions, then approach the IB questions. Also, don't be afraid to use past papers from the previous IB AAHL course, as there are a lot of questions that include concepts that overlap despite having a slightly different marking scheme. Last but not the least, tip number 10. Last and final tip is that don't overly stress about any of the papers, and especially your IA. Your IA is only worth 20%, and to get a 7 on your IA, the grade boundary is around 90%. This is way higher than the overall grade boundary, which was around or even lower than 70% for the past 2 years paper. So this means you don't necessarily need a 7 for your IA to score a final 7 for your AAHL course. Also, there are 3 papers for AAHL. So even if you didn't do well on your paper 1, for example, you can always drag it back by using your paper 2 and paper 3 or vice versa. So don't stress too much. Also, the grade boundaries are lower than what you've expected. At my high school, a 7 for maths is 80% plus for maths AAHL. However, the grade boundaries in reality are about 10% lower based on 2022 and 2021 papers. And with 220 marks for paper 1 and paper 2 together, and another 55 marks from paper 3, there's actually quite a lot of marks that you can lose and still get a 7. So that's all my 10 tips for maths AAHL. I hope this helped you, and best of luck for your exams. Last note, don't forget to subscribe, like, and comment below. Thank you.